Calling the meeting to order. Let's start with the roll call.
Councilman Daly.
Here.
Councilman Leonard.
Here.
Councilman Popescu.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tempore Duper.
Present.
Mayor Rigsby.
Here.
All present.
Thank you. We start with a closed session report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The City Council was in closed session regarding a potential litigation matter where a report was given, no action was taken. Nothing further to report at this time. On the Housing Authority agenda, there was a real property matter where, again, direction was given, but no final action at this time. Thank you.
Thank you for that. We will begin now with an invocation, Pledge of Allegiance, led by me. Please stand. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your leadership of our city in the past and the organizations that reside in this great town. We ask that you help us tonight with our deliberations to administer the city in the best way we can for the citizens. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are there any items to be added or deleted?
No, sir.
Okay, now we're at the part of the agenda where we get oral reports from the public on items not agendized. I have one request to speak from Elizabeth Al-Abbasi. Please come forward.
Good evening. Thank you for giving me this few minutes. I own the Shell station on Mountain View, right there on the 10 freeway. We've been open about a year this past November, and I have several other businesses in different cities. So I'm new to Loma Linda, and I've been a little shocked of what I've been finding. I gave you some copies. I have a business in the county of Riverside. My business license fees per year are approximately $30. Same business, gas station, convenience store, gasoline. If you turn the page, City of Harupa Valley, $31. Same business. City of Paris, $148. One license per business. I come to the City of Loma Linda. I have three business licenses, one for the car wash, one for the convenience store, one for the gasoline station. It's all the same building. Okay, the gas, I should say, the convenience store, $328. The car wash, $65.40. The gasoline station, $3,174.77. And I'll come back to that in a moment. And I also received this little white paper. There's another piece of paper right there with you. It's asking me for a list of every company that provides my vendors, that provides my product to me. Or if you turn it around too, they also want to know who the gardener is, who the uniform company is, who the paper goods supplier is, who the alarm security service person is, and who the vending machine providers. Before I came in, I counted all the files. I have 82 vendors. So that means for 82 people, I have to fill out company name, address, phone number, and the type of service I have. Guys, have you looked at this lately? Gasoline stations, I'm going to bring up, I don't mind paying a separate fee, but it can't be based on, I'm going to say, dollar amount of fuel, because right now we're blessed with, what, $2 and I think about $2.95 right now. But earlier last year, we were up at $5 a gallon. So I think if you want to tax us on what we're selling, it should be based upon our volume, our gallons. That would make a lot more sense. Needless to say, gasoline owners do not like a high price because we base what we make on the gallon. I might want to make 20 cents a gallon. And when prices go up, my credit card fees go up, because credit card fees can be anywhere from 2.5 to 3 cents. I mean, 3% per dollar. So as a gas station owner, we don't want to see prices higher. But I know I pay, to give you a chance, at about, I did some quick math. The state of California, as you know, gives us, we have to pay 2 cents a gallon for underground storage tank fees. That's approximately $19,200 per quarter, and that's based only upon 2 cents per gallon. So if you're going to look at this, keep that in mind. 2 cents a gallon business license fee would be about $19,000 a quarter. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you for that. It was very informative. As you know, with non-agendized items, the California state law doesn't allow us to act on anything, but we'll take that information. Thank you very much. Is there anyone else from the public who would like to speak on any non-agendized item? Seeing none, then we will move on to our scheduled items. We will be dealing with conflict of interest issues as the issues arise. We have a presentation. Loma Linda Colton, CERT co-recipients of the 2015 Governor's Award for Volunteer Programs. The fire department is doing the presentation.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council. I want to introduce Michael Ramirez. He is the emergency services. He's one of the emergency services officer for San Bernardino County Office of Emergency Services, and he's also the countywide CERT coordinator for all of the affiliated, non-affiliated CERT programs within the county.
All righty, Mayor, City Council. Thank you very much for allowing me to be here tonight. I just wanted to briefly make you familiar with something you're probably very familiar with already, which is your community emergency response team program. CERT exists for two reasons. We know that regardless of how great any department is in a major catastrophic event, professional responders will be overwhelmed for a time. We have a great mutual aid system in California. Help will get here, but it'll take time. In the meantime, we know people are going to volunteer and people are going to help. So we want to train them to do so safely. That's the second reason that CERT exists. We take Mexico City earthquake back in the 80s as an example. There were thousands of people that were saved by volunteer rescuers. In the process, about 100 of those volunteers died because they didn't know certain stop signs, not to go into collapsed buildings, not to deal with any down power lines or smoke-filled rooms, things along those lines. So that's why CERT exists. We know that professional responders will be overwhelmed, and we know people are going to help, so we want to train them to do so safely. Loma Linda CERT, under the direction of Shannon Kendall here, has played a significant role in better preparing themselves and their families in the event of a major disaster. As a CERT program in San Bernardino County, the city CERT program is part is part of being recognized as the 2015 Governor's Volunteering and Service Award Disaster Volunteer Program of the Year. The Governor's Award honors an outstanding California disaster volunteer program that has demonstrated an unwavering service commitment to the local community. City of Loma Linda CERT program has contributed significantly to this program by participating in the 2015 Operational Area Training and Exercise in June, where over 200 CERT programs and volunteers from throughout the county were involved in a full-day training and exercise, which helped to sharpen the life-saving skills that will be needed when the county has its next major disaster. This award is a recognition for all the work that Shannon has done in cooperation with the fire department. I see Chief Benfield there, who had a great part in it as well, with Colton and the partnership that the city has with the city of Colton as well, and better preparing the residents. It's an extremely important program, especially in light of things that are going on in the world today. We know we have natural disasters. Our December 2nd incident, you know, part of CERT is teaching about terrorism and the whole concept of if you see something, say something. So those important principles of people being involved in their communities. And this is the highest award for a volunteer disaster program that's given in the state. And Loma Linda, as well as all of our 35 CERT programs in the county, are part of this award. So I wanted to say thank you, and it's a great honor that all of these cities are involved. Shannon.
All right, thank you, Michael, for the recognition for all the work that Loma Linda CERT and Colton CERT has done in helping the county receive this award. Thank you, Chief Bender, Chief McCarr, Chief Benfield. I mean, there's a list. I can't list them all. I'll forget someone within the fire department and the city, JARB, who have supported the CERT program, recognizing the need for residents to be prepared and giving me the tools I need to be able to keep a group of volunteers trained within the city, and also the work I'm able to do with the county. So thank you.
So I should probably add to those comments, and honestly, Shannon, our thanks to you. I mean, yeah, we support, like you said, we provide the support, and with the council's direction and support of our department, but you're the one that makes it happen, honestly, with the CERT volunteers. I think we all know when volunteers are available, and it's after hours. So the nights, the weekends, the endless hours away that you put in here is remarkable. We appreciate that, not only to the CERT and response training, but I don't know if the council and the community has noticed, these people are augmenting our staff now at community events. Just recently putting sandbags together, preparing those for the rains and then their neighbors. So our hats off to the program that Deb started, and really you've continued to grow and the recognition that the county's giving. So we appreciate your efforts and all the team.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. It's great to know that we've got such good programs. Our next is a bittersweet moment. We're celebrating the tenure of Jamie Gray, our fire marshal, for the last 7 years or so. Promoted to fire marshal seven years before the retirement. And we thank you for your service. Because of the length of your service, you get a plaque. If you'd been here as long as some of the other people, you get rocking chairs and all kinds of things. And it understates our appreciation for what you've done. But, it's just, we're an egalitarian society and you get a plaque. But that's you deserve right. Way more. So
thank
we
you.
Really appreciate you. You came into this role in the shoes of someone who was a legend. And you really filled the shoes very well. You've got a lot of style and a lot of panache, and I just personally appreciate what you've done. And I'm sure there are several other people who are going to sing your praises, but that's my share of it.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you. For me, I got to thank you all very much. I've had a wonderful career, truly. Right now in this audience, there are guys, brothers, that I've known for more than 25 years and truly are amazing friends. You said, you know, I had an opportunity to come to fire prevention when Chief Crawford retired. Life is funny. I was on the floor with these guys, and I developed a funky heartbeat. And right about that same time, Chief Crawford retired, and fire prevention is known as the dark side. Most firemen don't know much about fire prevention and don't want to, really, not because they have other things. And I had the opportunity to come here, and I truly, because of that, I have met amazing people in this city. Amazing. From the people I work with, Diana, Pam, the folks behind over here, Guillermo, on and on and on. And more importantly, the guys behind me right now, the people, the contractors, the project managers, the people that I've been able to interact with, and you guys as well, to be able to interact with people. I think the team that we had, Jim Shea, myself, the crews when they went out and did inspections, we've made this city a safer place. And for me, the last 8 years or 7.5 years now in prevention, it's been a full, it's made my career complete. It really has. I've seen the fire department from very, 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 virtually every angle, and I have thoroughly, thoroughly enjoyed in this job that I've done here with the city. So thank you very, very much. Thank you.
So the mayor was right. There are more comments. And I think I'd like to share a couple of very important points that I think, Jamie, you brought to this community and our department. And you touched on one of them there. It's that dichotomy between prevention and suppression. On one hand, we have our operations side who does everything they can to make sure these guys meet operational standards and performance standards to go fight fire. That's what they train to every day. On the other side, you're trying to prevent them from ever using the skills that they work to develop every day. And I think we do a pretty good job of that. One thing you instilled in the crews is to try to understand the value of that, to try to understand that if that fire never happens, or if with the fire sprinkler system and your quick response, we can minimize the damage, put that business back in service instead of strip malls where you look around the valley that never come back. Our businesses and our incidents, typically, we're able to get them back in service. Ultimately, that means a thriving business community, tax dollars to the community, which are the essential resources we need to provide essential services. So we have young people in the department now growing up with those concepts instead of fighting the dark side, as you coined it there, really understanding of, okay, here's how we work together, and also educating them on the life safety systems you engineered into projects. So you have a state code that's rigorous language, and a lot of that's built in for their safety, and a lot of times they don't necessarily know all those details unless someone takes the time to take them out there and point that out. So there's time and effort to do that and to get them to really bring the two sides of the department together. And I think we can hold our heads high of any department around here where prevention and suppression are really walking lockstep. So the other piece would be kind of describe that relationship you've had in our community with the businesses. I am Ken's behind me, and I can know it from him and his staff. They've felt some of those same things from our institutions, in that you didn't sit in your office and write letters back on, okay, well, here's what code says, too bad, go deal with this. You were in the community daily, getting your boots dirty, working hand in hand to find solutions, to interpret the code, find a solution to keep people moving forward instead of just stopping business, shutting down until they resolve the problem. You were a solution-oriented working with our projects. And when the word of your retirement got to the community, I received quite a few phone calls making sure when we recruited behind you, we would find someone with that same attitude and willingness to get out and work hands in hand with the developers, with the institutions, to find solutions to the problem instead of just issuing them letters of, here's what the code said, and you're out of business until you fix it. So those things have been huge to keep our institutions accredited, to keep businesses moving forward, and to educate the next generation in the value of what that code means for their life. So thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you.
And I was wrong. You also get a pen.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I guess my question is, who's going to do our weed abatement reports now?
Can we introduce a new fire marshal?
We probably should. I should probably ask Division Chief and Fire Marshal Tim Bradfield to stand. And if you haven't met Tim yet, Tim has replaced Fire Marshal Gray in that position. And I think he just heard a good speech on the expectation. And the
bigger shoes to fill.
So welcome, Tim, and thanks for what you're doing for us.
Looks like there's a height requirement to be a fire marshal. They're both over 6 foot tall.
It's not easy telling people they have to do things they don't want to do. So we appreciate those who do, are willing to do it. Okay, now we go to the public hearing on Council Bill R-2015-40. Establishing a schedule of fees and charges for city services.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I would like to introduce Mr. Eric Johnson of Revenue and Cost Specialist. He helped us prepare the updated fee study that we'd like to for you to review and approve tonight, and we can update our fee. Mr. Johnson, please.
Thank you, Jared. Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. I'm Eric Johnson from Revenue and Cost Specialist, and just wanted to take you through the what we did on this report and why we did it and the results. First, a little background on me and my company. Revenue and Cost Specialist has been around since 1980, and basically in the wake of Proposition 13, a couple city managers and finance directors got together and realized cities were going to need to be able to track their costs like businesses, because that's what the voters told them to do. So they really pioneered that concept of matching costs with revenues. I myself have been doing this for 26 years. Oh my gosh. Over 26 years now, worked in almost 100 different agencies, mostly in California. Worked with Loma Linda a number of times over those 26 years. So what have we done? We've really recast the city budget as if it were a business on a one-time basis. And so what does that mean? Well, first off, you're not going to stay in business if you don't know what it costs to provide services to your customers. And so you won't see a city council service in here. You won't see a city manager service. You'll see the services that provide the end services to the customer. Just like when you go to the grocery store. You know when you buy that can of corn, you know that that includes the cost for the farmer, the cost for the transportation, the cost for the people at the grocery store. You know it includes all those things when you look at that price. We've done the same thing with city services. So we've identified what is the full cost, including the support cost, for those services that you're providing to the public. We've also matched up revenues with costs because, again, you're not going to stay in business very long if you don't know, if you don't match up your revenues and your costs. How did we do it? We really sat down with staff and identified what are the services being provided and who's providing them. We did this for the city more than 10 years ago, and so we were starting with that as our basically our starting point, that we wanted to update those time allocations and those staff allocations. And as you know, the city staff has changed a lot in those last 10 years. And so we needed to go through and identify who's providing the services now. Are there any changes to these the times that it takes to provide these services? How many of them are you doing? So we had a number of meetings with staff to identify those time allocations and who's providing that. We took a look at the city budget. We identified the operational costs that we needed to allocate. We took a look at the city salaries, so we're looking at people's actual salaries and the benefits that they're receiving. We calculated an overhead rate, both a city overhead rate and a department overhead rate. And of course, with the changes in the administrative staff in the city over the last 10 years, the general city overhead rate went down quite a bit. And so as you go through here, these costs, while it's been 10 years and you would typically expect some very large changes in the fees, have really been attenuated because of those changes by the administrator, by the city to lower the amount of administrative costs. We then took a look at those fully burdened hourly rates. So we developed a fully allocated hourly rate, salaries, benefits, operating expenses, that city overhead rate, that department overhead rate, to come up with the full cost of each employee in the city We then matched that up with the time. Now we know what it costs to provide these services to the public. And so we looked at all the services that are provided to the public. So there are fee services in this report, those things that either are fees or could be fees. But we also identified all the other things that the city provides, you know, the sheriff services, fire services, maintenance services, all those things that when people pay their tax dollars, that's what they're paying their tax dollars for. We then took a look at the recovery percentages, make sure that based on the past, where in most cases the city had wanted to recover 100% of the cost, we adjusted the fees that we're proposing here tonight to, in most cases, recover 100% of those fully allocated costs. Again, trying to frame it as if you were a business. What does it cost to provide these services to our customers? And again, we broke out those community-supported services, tax-supported services versus personal choice services, fee-supported services. At the end of the day, you as a city council decide what is a community-supported service and what is a personal choice service by where you set the fees. Because when we're looking at local government, I generally look at things better in pictures. And so when we look at local government in California, there's basically two pots of money, taxes and grants and fees. Proposition 13, we were told by the voters that we're going to control the property tax portion of those taxes and grants. Passed a year later was Proposition 4, which said, amongst other things, that cities can charge the cost reasonably borne to provide services to the public for those services that they're receiving an extra level of service, a different level of service. And so that's what we've done here. We've matched up those taxes and grant with those community-supported services, things like police and fire and maintenance, and we matched up the fees with personal choice services, those things that you see in the book and in the proposed fee schedule. Now, to the extent that fees don't cover the cost of providing the service, service is still being provided. So it only has one place to be funded from, and that's from taxes. So again, you as a council decide whether it's a personal choice service or whether it's a community-supported service and how much it's a community-supported service or a personal choice service. Because again, to the extent that the fees aren't recovering 100% of the cost, it's coming out of your tax pie. It's coming out of that tax dollar pot. That means you have less money to spend on police and fire and maintenance because you've decided that these services over here are important enough to use our limited tax dollars to fund. But again, you make the final decision. Our goal of this was to identify the full cost of providing services, and we've done that. We've made few recommendations for every personal choice service. And it's now up to the City Council to decide where you want to go with these fee services. Now, the book has a lot of detail in it. There's the summary schedule. There's the fee resolution. For every one of those services, there is a detail sheet that identifies what are the costs of the service, who's involved, how much time they're involved, how many of them you're doing. And that's all that work that we had done with staff to identify those numbers, those time numbers, those, and then coming up with those cost allocation numbers. So behind each one of these are the cost details for what it costs to provide the service here in the city of Loma Linda. We didn't go into another city and say, what does it cost to provide that service there? We didn't do a survey of what other cities are charging for a number of reasons. One big reason is we don't know why another city's charging what they're charging. We don't know if they've gone through this process and looked at their full cost. We don't know if they've then decided to subsidize certain things. But we do know what it costs to provide that service here in Loma Linda. And at the end of the day, you have to decide who should pay for that service. Should it be the taxpayer, or should it be the person receiving the benefit of that service?
Let me ask you a question. Do you do benchmarking against other local communities? When you say we don't know what the true costs are, that, well, I stumble on that to begin with, but then are there benchmarks that we're looking at?
A number of years ago, I realized I had all this data. We've been doing this for a number of cities, and we had all this data, especially in the planning area. What is it? Every city has a conditional use permit. And so I started putting together this big database of time information and found out it was all over the place. It had a huge range such that the numbers weren't meaningful. And the reason for that is that every city defines it differently. Every city has a conditional use permit, but every city defines differently what goes into that, what processes they put into that. And so looking at an individual application, it's very, very difficult to compare across agencies. But what we can do is when we look at that time allocation data is break down the steps. The time it takes to meet with an applicant should be relatively the same from agency to agency to agency. And so I bring that experience to me when I come and look at sit down with staff and go through that time data. Same thing for the different steps in the process. And so when different steps in the process don't make sense to me, I'll ask why is that so high or so low, and we'll go back and forth with staff. And sometimes there's a good reason for it. Sometimes there's a different process here. We do something differently. But it's that part of the process that we get comfort with the time it takes to do things here.
I'd like to offer something that maybe will help Councilman Daly. And coincidentally, we were provided with some evidence of this earlier in the meeting tonight.
That is a little different. Sorry to interrupt. That's taxes versus fees.
No, it's actually not, because the person who was up here talking was, I think, confused, because they provided a copy of business license registration fees from the other cities and was comparing that to her taxes charged here in the city of Loma Linda. So clearly she was very confused as to what she was actually presenting. However, she provided us evidence of what business license fees are in other communities. And guess what? It's almost exactly what your proposal is here in this city. So to answer your question, it is actually on par with what other communities are charging. Currently, we charge nothing for a business license renewal. However, other cities have charged her $30 a year, and your proposal is to charge $30 a year as a renewal for a business license. So again, what she brought us was copies, great for this topic, evidence of what other people charge for a business license, and somehow is confused with her tax role in the community and thinking that, I'm not sure how she's still in business with that problem, but obviously that she needs to sort that out. But thank you very much. So we are on par.
For these fees.
For one out of this whole book.
That's true.
I had some questions. It talked about recovering something like $489,000. Is that assuming that we provided every one of those services in a given year?
If you followed every recommendation in this book and the volume of service was roughly the same as we presented here, that would be the amount of annual revenue you could expect.
Okay. In the business world, when a business says it's a cost, it means that they ended up having to bill somebody else for it because they weren't generating enough revenue. So I'm just curious, if it's costing the city all these fees, who are we billing? So does that mean that if we get $489,000, we're going to be giving to someone else that cost us that additional amount of money? Or are we giving employees raises for $489,000?
If everything else stays the same, it means you have more tax dollars to spend on things like police and fire and maintenance. And so it goes in the general fund. It goes in the general fund. There's a few water fees in here that go into the water fund, but it's a very minimal amount. The vast majority goes in the general fund. And again, it's lowering the amount that's going from the tax pot to the personal choice services. So that means you have more money in that tax pot.
I would venture to guess that some constituents would argue that many of these fees are what they believe the city should provide them as far as a service, not necessarily a choice, versus other people saying, well, your only taxes only pay for your road, but if you decide to build a new road, we're going to charge a little bit more for inspecting the process. So I guess you're going to have difference of opinion as to whether it's personal choice or it's something that should be provided. I'll take fire, for example. I noticed that for fire, we apparently generate revenue of $150,000. I'm not sure where that's coming from, but yet we spend $4 million. Well, clearly the taxes are paying for that. So we're not going to be able to recuperate most of that because we are already by taxes. Right. So there are a number of things in here that I think can clearly fall into the category of not personal choice, but a service that I think citizens would expect the city to provide with, and therefore they're paying property taxes and all the other things for it. So,
however, you got to remember that, again, we want to continue to provide a certain level of service, and when the state keeps taking more and more and more of that tax increment away from us and it doesn't come back into the city, people think, I pay taxes and it goes directly into my local government and I should get these services. But probably a lot of people in this community don't appreciate the way the state takes their money and spends it in other places, not here in this community. So what do you do as a city? What do any of the cities do in this state when that happens? Do you just let the services go? Do you fold up, close up shop, and go home? Or do you find a way to push back and go, okay, to continue to do this, what we need to do, we have to figure out a way to levy it? I mean, I understand it's not, we're not making this stuff up. These numbers are clearly right here, and they're not out of the ordinary, and they don't affect every single citizen. Obviously, there are a lot of different categories here of different things. So may it affect one or two people, a couple of dollars here or there when they pay for their copies instead of us just giving them away, or you know, we charge for an inspector to go out and do an inspection as opposed to we just provide that service for, quote unquote, for free. How do we continue to operate as responsible government and ensure our citizens are getting what they need to get? So,
And I'm sorry, and there are certain services in here where we've recommended a subsidy level. The engine company inspections within the fire department are, the city council has said in the past they want to recover 50% of those costs. So in other words, there's about a half the benefit is for that business owner, about a half the benefit is for the community at large. And so we're keeping that same 50% recovery level, updating the cost and the fee to represent that 50%, but still saying that there is a benefit to the community, but at the same time there's a benefit to the person receiving the inspection.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but did we not increase some of these fees at some point in the last 5 years? I thought we, especially as related
to... We reviewed it, I don't know, in 2012, I think our fire prevention, we looked at fire prevention specifically.
Yeah, I was thinking just in construction for some of our, will we charge for permits or anything like that?
That for development impact fee.
Yes.
That's different. And actually, yes, that one we lower on a lot of category. Okay. Development impact fee. This is the fee for people ask for permit and different category.
The operational fees. To recover the cost of staff.
But just to follow up on the same theme that Councilman Popescu has raised, did I understand you to say that we went through this fee adjustment process 10 years ago?
2004, more than 10 years ago.
For the operational fees. Seems like an awful long time for me. Can you help me understand it?
Yes, what happened during the last 7 years is really not much going on as far as people coming to pull permit. Yes. So that's why we just start updating development impact fee and this fee just recently, just because things are turning around. And
so when would we next intend
to do it for every 5 years.
I generally recommend every 3 to 5 years.
But what happening is due to this 5-6 years ago, we reduced 25% of our workforce, and so that's why, like Conrad and I, we wear multiple hats and we be able to lower our overhead.
Okay. Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
If you look, there's a lot of categories where there is no new revenue generated, and some of the categories where you do see significant revenue generated, for example, but. A sixth of this $483,000, more than that, is $54,000 in business registration renewals. And again, our current model is we do not charge anything for a business license renewal. We have evidence here that three other municipalities charge $30 a year. The proposal is we charge $30 a year. To me, that's not unreasonable for a business, but it could net $54,000 of additional $54,000 of additional revenue.
We have that many businesses?
According to this study. So it's on Schedule 1, page 4 of 4. So
that would be...
Again, I mean, if that doesn't
1,800 businesses. It just seems
almost 1,800 businesses.
That's a lot.
I see another big one is... engine company inspections. So we've struggled with the last couple of years with ever increasingly depleted resources when it comes to our fire. I'm assuming, Chief, that that's when an engine company has to go out and do an inspection, correct? On an actual engine.
Yeah, there's.
So we don't have extra engines that sit around with engine crews.
No,
so
that's
that would
what
be
they're doing during the day.
That would be an on-duty crew that probably takes them out of a rotation or Maybe they can't get to those inspections because they're handling other calls for service, and we know we've seen an increased load of calls for service, right? What are we up to now? We were just talking about this the other day.
3,600
calls for service a year from our fire department, which, I mean, that's a significant impact. And so now we take them and ask them to go out and do these inspections. And again, that, you know, to me, it just doesn't seem unreasonable. I think what we're trying to figure out is, are we providing efficient service, and are we actually doing what we should be doing, being fiscally responsible to the rest of the community? So,
I could use some help in understanding what the action is that we take on this. I understand that this is a proposal establishing a new schedule of fees and charges for city services. Help me understand the repealing of resolution, the 1, 2, 3, 4 resolutions.
When we adopt a new resolution, excuse me, so we have one place to look, we rescind the former resolutions. Either the former resolutions fees have been updated, or they've remained the same, but all of the fees that are in these former resolutions are in the new resolution at either the same rate or the new rate.
Okay, so it's updating everything in one location.
It's one place.
Location.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
So staff recommendation is for the city council to approve this fee study update. But because it's a public hearing, you need to open up for a public hearing first. Thank you.
Are there any other questions from council? We need to do the public hearing.
Yeah, I do have one other question, and it takes us back to where I started. I appreciate your comprehensive explanation. I understand it better now. I'm still interested in knowing, however, if there was an effort to compare and contrast the new proposed fees against cities in our general Inland Empire location.
We had the largest changes in the fire prevention fees and the specialty fire plan check and inspection. I believe, Chief, you did a...
Well, with our last study, we provided some other examples. I don't have that with us with your presentation tonight, but we've done that work before. And it was clearly we were behind. When we brought this to council 3.5 years ago, at the time it was because people at the counters were asking us, do you know what your fees are? And the answer at the time was it was intentionally so. And at the time, the council looked at it and you made an intentional decision. We understand we're subsidizing this and we're behind, but I think the economy was completely flat. Nothing was moving, and you asked us to bring this back in 2 or 3 years when things might change. So at that time in the presentation, actually, Fire Marshal Gray put that together, and we are substantially behind our neighboring jurisdictions with our fire prevention.
In terms of fire inspection fees and so forth.
If you go out to review and inspect a set of plans, then to go out and do an inspection on the devices, you know, on the implementation. So those fees we were substantially behind. That's our little piece of the whole study, but I know that because we had looked at it and we had addressed fire prevention specifically at that time. It wasn't a citywide review of the fees. It was really because Jamie was running into developers and people at the counter just kind of saying, hey, is this real? Is this the real fee? So it caused us to look into it, and we were behind. We have kind of in the transition from Jamie to Fire Marshal Bradfield, we've got some services, some plan check help to help us through the transition. Definitely those fees are in the ballpark or higher than what we're proposing. So I don't think we're out of the proposed fees or out of place for what we're seeing out in the area.
And with the other fees, there were more incremental changes. So they certainly weren't out of line with what I've seen in other cities that I've worked with, but we didn't do a formal comparison again because it's just so difficult to take a conditional use permit in one city and match it up with a conditional use permit in the other city and have it be a meaningful comparison.
Yeah. I understand what you're saying. In all due respect, I mean, it's not an impressive argument for me. There should be a way to be sure you're comparing apples with apples, or at least within reason. Because consumers that come in, if they're pulling a building permit, they know what they're paying, whether it's here or Redlands or Colton or wherever. I would think there would be some way that we would ensure that there's a similar formula in terms of identifying what ingredients go into that fee. I have a hard time believing that we have no idea how our fees compare with some of the cities surrounding us.
However, I mean, state law doesn't allow us to, quote unquote, make money off of these things. I mean, we're not in business. Right. So when the evaluator looks at what it costs us to do business and how to recoup those fees, and he establishes a number, that number could be drastically different than what, say, Redlands, because of employee costs or whatever Redlands has that's different from us. I mean, there's so many different factors. So to put Loma Linda and Redlands against each other, I understand what you're saying. You can't do that necessarily. But Redlands on its own, legally by law, can only and should only be charging what their actual cost is.
Businesses do that as a matter of routine. It's the free market system.
I
understand the point, but I still think we ought to be able to do better with that. And
so basically what you're saying is that to the extent we don't take the recommendations, we're subsidizing a service.
Correct, with tax dollars.
Okay. And one of the kind of side effects of your analysis is that you're almost like an efficiency consultant. Even though they're not asking you that question, it goes into your analysis because you're basically saying how many hours it takes to do it, what it costs per hour, and whatever materials and things like that. And that's the kind of thing you're analyzing, correct?
It is, but I'm not saying this is how much time it should take. I want to know how much time it does take. And
yeah,
so
that's what I'm saying. And so you would know because of your knowledge going back. You say 1980, your letterhead says 1975. You guys have been in business for a long time. Knowing what you know, is there anything in our efficiency in the amount of time it takes us to do one of these things that just shocks you, or is everything pretty much in line?
That comes up in some cities I work in where someone tells me it takes this much time, and after we break it down even further, it truly does take that much time. Hmm. I did not find that here in Loma Linda. This is an extremely lean organization, certainly one of the leanest I've come across, and so that has its pluses and minuses.
That's what I was looking for, because you're an inadvertent efficiency consultant, or at least
I've seen a lot of different ways of doing things.
Or at least you're a recorder or a noter of efficiency. So
that's why Jarb has gray hair.
My next question has to do with means and standard deviations. What do you do when you've got someone who, let's say, this San Bernardino city inspector, who inspects, a 2 million square foot facility, and then goes in the next day and inspects, or the next month inspects, a little 1,000 square foot storefront? What do you do in those circumstances? You have categories that divide it up, so you're not, whacking somebody with the average in that.
Right, exactly. When you get past a certain standard deviation, you do want to look at the fee differently. So sometimes it just means you look at it with the deposit and strictly time and materials, if it makes sense for that service. Other times you break it into categories. You'll see certain fees in here that have different categories, the engine company inspection being one. There's small businesses, there's larger businesses, there's apartments, because it does take different amounts of time to do different parts of a service. So yeah, we will definitely look at that.
That was very helpful. Any other questions? Because we're ready for the public hearing.
I'm actually kind of proud to say that we're lean like that. And
extremely lean.
Yeah, extremely lean. I think as well.
Dangling.
I think it was my first city council.
I'm out here.
I think in my very first city council, we talked something about this, and I said that we were comparing with another city, and I said, I don't like the idea that we compare to other cities and say, hey, we're charging less, we should jack our fees up. I think what we should be looking at is comparability studies to see, hey, are we way off? Are we charging more than everybody else? And if we can do something more efficiently and do it more cheaper, I hesitate just to raise the price, because then you do the spiral thing. Oh, hey, Loma Linda plays their prices, so Redlands puts theirs up, and then Bernal Valley puts theirs up. And if we can do things more efficient and cheaper, we should do it.
But it sounds like what he's doing is he's figuring our cost of labor multiplied by the number of very efficient hours that are used to provide a service. That's where the fee comes from, and it doesn't. None of it comes from benchmarking.
Correct.
Right. Yeah. But we are able to offer it for cheaper because we're more efficient, so I like that.
Yeah, it's good.
So when you put the donut on your car because you got a flat and you don't want to pay for the new tire and you drive around with the donut, eventually that donut will fail and it's going to hurt you in more ways than just the tire. Simple analogy.
But in this case, the difference is that that we have the responsibility of providing a decent tire either way, independent of who's paying for it, whether it's the general public. So basically what we're deciding is, does the general public subsidize somebody's personal choice service? So that's basically what it comes down to. And it's a political philosophy. Is government here to provide freebies to everybody to a few people at some people's expense, or do people have to pay their own freight? And the general services, the community-supported services, are those that we all agree are part of the collective. So we're basically separating the collective from the individual.
Which is fine. I mean, I always feel like people ought to pay user fees. What do I care if you build some giant house? Why should I pay for that? You should have to pay for that. Right? Same sort of thing.
Are you looking
Why
at me?
Why is he looking at you?
You know, one example that I know we talked about when we presented this before that we faced was one fee we had for fire alarm checks and inspections on the installation. So we had at the time 50 devices and up was $385. So a multi-story commercial building went into the city. So we had our fire marshal and inspector there, better part of a week or more, seeing to all the details in that construction, in that building. It was still $385. The recommendation would have, okay, $50 devices, and then over $150, there's another increment. So we subsidized with tax dollars this, you know, new developed multi-story commercial building, where it's kind of addresses your question of the guy with the smaller business versus bigger business. This recommendation does have ways to scale up and address that appropriately. But if that gives you an idea of what we've done before, you know, that kind of time and effort spent for 300, you know, there's a lot more to that cost. So those are the kinds of things we do currently.
Any other questions? If not, then I will open the public hearing with my trusty hammer. Come forward.
Double tap? Did you close it now too?
No, it was. I'm opening, and that's two syllables. Open, close. Okay, two for open, one for close. Okay. Any comments? This is a big one. Nobody. Okay. Well. Want to come forward? Please come forward. Are you a resident elector?
Just to clear up a couple of things of your concerns. 4 years ago, we did do, or I did, and with Jim, a very comprehensive survey with Redlands, Colton, San Bernardino, Montana, to compare our fees to those other agencies. Councilman Duper is absolutely correct. The code will not allow a city to make money on your fees. Anything to do with in my realm at the time, the fire department, the fire prevention. So the example that the chief gave you was one of the more worse examples are the gravity of it all, where we could have a multi-story building and spend better part of 80 team hours inspecting it, going over it, going back and meeting with the contractors and doing what we do for $385. And you had 80 hours of staff time. So we that was the nexus at that point for me to do a survey with these four other cities, and across the board, whether it was a hydrant test for a contractor to be able to determine what kind of sprinklers to put in his building, we were minuscule compared to other cities. Not because we should make money, but because we weren't even covering. We were, and I remember, you all remember at the time that you decided the economy was poor, you decided it's better for us at this point to subsidize, and we have been doing that for 4 years, or 5 years now. So now the economy is turning around, as you can see, and we are still charging that $385 or $50 for a plan check that really hours invested by your staff would relate to what the report has shown, and not to make money in a sense of now we're getting more income. No, it's just covering the costs of your staff to do the work. So if that helps.
No, and I appreciate that. To the contrary of some of the comments, the implication of my questions were not to be able to raise our fees to the fees that may be higher than ours. It would be just the opposite, to be more competitive. Mm. I have heard in past years, many years ago now, that Loma Linda was an expensive city to do business in. I think we need to know that. It doesn't mean we're going to try to compete with others in terms of jacking our fees up to match others. In fact, to the contrary, I think we should want to be more competitive mm-hmm. with others. And anybody that's in any kind of a business, you want to know what your competitors are up to. So I stand by my question mm-hmm. that I think it's appropriate and even important to know what the context is for our fees. But clearly it should require some kind of an algorithm that also involves what's the cost of providing that kind of service too. So I don't want to oversimplify this.
Yeah. And I
appreciate your
explanation. I just wanted you to know that four years ago we did a very comprehensive survey with the other cities to see where we did land, if you will, compared to the other four right around our perimeter here.
Yeah, I appreciate knowing that. Thank you, Jamie.
Any other comments from the public? I will attempt to hit this just once. The public hearing is closed. What's the pleasure of the council?
I'm going to move this item. I think it's warranted and it's not egregious. It makes sense. It's pretty clear to me. So I appreciate, and I know we often joke about the hard work that our staff does every day, but I also think there's a breaking point, and you can't accept staff, and you can't accept or expect an organization or an entity to continue working hard without eventually giving them some type of relief, and maybe this is some type of relief in a way that we can do other things, better things in the community. Our city manager can do other projects, who knows what, but I think this is a positive step in the right direction, so I move this.
Second.
I have a question. You list a special event permit as being no current fee. So what is it that we have been waiving on multiple occasions?
I don't know for sure, but I'm willing to bet it was probably the day. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
We went through a process of waiving special event fees for a period, and then we received instruction from council at some point when you reached your breaking point of waiving fees that we're just not going to charge for them anymore. And at that point, special event fees are free, although, you know, something like the, for example, the Lopers thing that went on here a month or so ago, took, you know, somewhere in the range of 60 to 80 hours of staff time just to process the paperwork and all the preparation and everything else to get the event going. That was free. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you for that. My belief is that special events are part of the collective, but that's just my perspective on that. Part of the collective, I think that there are things that general tax dollars can support, and I'm in favor of a lower fee than what is being proposed on that particular fee, but that's just because it's been so politically charged here over the last several years. It was $300, and now it's going to $865, and yeah, I can just imagine the reaction. Whatever.
However, what happens when we, if we become a town of an event every weekend?
Then we can revisit it. But I don't, has there been any flood of applications for special events beyond, because we're so cheap?
We're not bringing in any events that we're not relocating other events from other communities to us because it's free. The events we have are events that are organic and happen because of what we are as a community, yes. And I think as Scott said, you know, these fees are up to you guys to pick and choose and adjust as you see accordingly, line by line and item by item, if that's the way the council sees that.
I saw you were looking at me when you said that. He was looking at me around your head when he said about it was like Einstein bending the light around. I have, as I said before, I have no problem charging for that. I wouldn't care if we charge that fee on everybody who had an event. In fact, I think it might needs to be higher because every time I try to drive out to go to the coffee shop, I can't seem to get on Sunday morning where I'm supposed to go because somebody's telling me I can't drive there because somebody's having an event. So I'd almost rather jack those fees up so they wouldn't have any. Yeah, so I get my coffee.
There goes your reelection campaign.
Yeah, there's my reelection campaign. What I objected to before was just picking and choosing who got their fee waived. And I just think that if we're going to charge it, we should charge it and charge what it costs, and that's fine. But don't be waiving it because somebody's politically connected or knows somebody or has a brother-in-law or something like that. Or nobody does it. Really, I'd rather that whoever did it should pay and keep the taxes lower. In my idea of user fees, people should pay user fees. But since we were picking and choosing, I'd rather nobody paid. That was
But since we don't control the tax rates, that part of the equation isn't there. You know, we can't
speaking philosophically.
Yeah, exactly. But we can't, you know, people don't realize the very few taxes that we actually impose. They're imposed by the state, and we just get a share of it. I don't know if you guys have been paying attention, but lately we haven't been spending all the tax revenue that comes because we are very efficient. We really appreciate our city council. We really appreciate our city staff because of that. It's not our. We didn't.
That's his reelection campaign.
We
right
didn't
there.
Do it. No, it's the city staff.
We appreciate our mayor.
The city staff. The city staff are very efficient in Loma Linda, and the state has seen fit to tax you at a rate that's higher than what we need to provide the services. Now, we have forestalled some maintenance. We've forestalled some equipment replacement because of hard times in order to get those modest surpluses. But, you know, at some point, you know, we can't really use the argument, we're doing this to keep your taxes low, because your taxes stay high whether we spend the money or not. And if we spend more than the governor and the legislature allocate to us, then we basically go bankrupt, and that doesn't do you much good either. So we have decided it's better to have a surplus than a deficit. But I just think there are certain things where we, as the representatives of the citizens, decide, you know, this is for the collective. You know, our society, for better or for worse, has decided schools are part of the collective. Common defense of the country is a collective. Fire and police are a collective. But in our case, the rescue of medical cases that happen to pile up outside medical institutions are not necessarily the collective, so we have a fee for that. And I just, in my judgment, special events are kind of the life's blood of a community, and I just would like to have them supported by the collective, but that's just my perspective.
Well, I have several thoughts. One is I wish we had the ability to actually go into more detail on which fees we should raise and which we shouldn't, rather than blanket on everything.
You can stall the vote.
Well, I mean, not to belabor the point, but when it comes to development fees, I believe that the part of the reason the city is so nice is because we make it a little stricter and harder for people to develop here, and we have a higher standard. And we're gonna, I have no problem with, you know, raising the fees for things like that. Having said that, my general philosophy, and it doesn't necessarily apply to the city, is that we are overtaxed, and our government is not efficient. I mean, that's the bottom line. Having said that, the city of Loma Linda, in the last 7 years that we've been here, we've actually managed to actually build our surplus. Unlike city of San Bernardino, who's raising fees just to survive because they cannot provide all their services, we're not in that position. We're actually arguing that we have enough money, we just want a little bit more. Before I even try to raise fees, I like to get a better understanding that it's costing us more, and the way we're going to address that is with this money, we're actually going to hire extra bodies, or we believe our people are underpaid and perhaps we need to pay them a little bit more. The fact that it wasn't too long ago that I think someone mentioned that employment in Loma Linda was ranked one of the most desirable places to work for. That's a testament to the fact that our employees are happy and they're well compensated and they provide a good service, and I think we all agree in that. The fact that, in spite of the fact that the economy has not done so well, and yet we've managed to provide all of our services, yes, by cutting down staff and in certain areas even salaries, is a testament to the fact that we are able to survive in spite of that. So it's not like this is a dire situation. My concern is that if we're really being honest with the voters, we would just put an item on the agenda and say, you know what, folks, we don't have enough money. We would like to do more. We'd like to hire more firefighters. We'd like to hire more police, but we don't. So we've come up with a proposal. We're going to go ahead and just increase your taxes, and we get to get all of you get to vote for it, you know, increase the taxes. But instead, we as like five of us can decide to raise fees to generate that money, which in essence is a tax. Yes, it's not for everyone and it's case-by-case basis, but to that individual who's having to pay, his taxes just got raised. So philosophically, I would be opposed to approving for this. There are certain fees that I am would favor, but blanketly just increasing everyone's fees is not something that I would agree into doing. I do agree with Dr. Daly, which is, you know, we are, even though we're a government entity, we are competing with other cities for revenue and businesses, and it would be nice for us to compare and contrast and see how we, you know, how well we do. We were fortunate enough to bring in business into the city that generated a significant amount of tax revenue. I think that's the way we bring in, increase the coffers of the city by bringing more economic activity, not necessarily charging our residents or businesses for the privilege of doing business in our city. So I would be opposed to this because of that philosophical difference.
I have to just comment about what you just said. I think this is a unique community that business should want to inhabit. And if it is not a high-functioning, safe, efficient community, why would a business want to come here? So I use San Bernardino as the model, because why not? We'll throw rocks at them. We've done it all night. When that city is overrun by crime and just horrific conditions, no business wants to go there. But yet, in order to survive, they have to attract business. And they're in a conundrum.
how do you attract business when you can't attract business? So how do you generate revenue when nobody wants to do business there? And they're in a vicious cycle. And I think what makes Loma Linda attractive is our certain demographic, our crime rate, our you know, what aesthetically what our city looks like, those things that we have to keep and maintain. And I feel like we're hovering dangerously playing this game with, hey, we've been able to do it. We did it last year. We saved a little bit more money. We've got more money in the bank. We saved a little bit more. We got more money in the bank. And yet things around us, costs are increasing for all kinds of services, police, fire, things like that. We're seeing more crime. We're seeing things where our current model of way we do business is not going to be able to maintain. Driving the car with the donut, we're not going to continue to be able to provide those services. And if we don't think ahead and plan ahead, we won't be able to maintain this beautiful, healthy, crime-free community that's going to want to attract the business. And if we somehow fall below that threshold, San Bernardino's way below that threshold, what happens? Do we start losing that attractiveness, and then do we end up in that cycle? So I think I just heard him do it. I mean, but we've heard our city manager, I'm wearing too many hats. I've got all this stuff. And he does a great job, and we keep pushing. And we do that with all of our services. And as a resident here, yes, it bothers me that our engine companies and the fire inspectors are out. And that big building was probably the VA building that we're talking about with the fees, right? Okay, so that one's coming. So we're talking about a lot of time that they're going to spend out there, which is time they're not ready to come to my house if there's a fire. So I don't know. I'm being very simplistic. I'm trying to be simplistic, but I just think I want to maintain this community. Look at places like Irvine. Look at places like in our own county, Rancho Cucamonga. They're a place that people want to be, and there's a reason for that, because they put a certain amount of money, not wasteful. We don't do that. I don't think we've ever had a history of doing anything like that. But they put a certain amount into that community to make it attractive, why people and businesses want to go there. I just want to make sure that's what we're doing.
So what I'm proposing is an amendment to decrease the special event permit.
Proposal, I will amend. I don't think we have, and I'm good with that one, but I just don't think we have the time and ability to go through every single one of these. I think we have an expert that provided a report. In his own words, he's not over the top. We're not being over the top. We're not getting crazy with all this. I just don't want to get into a line by line go through all of these things, because we just don't have the time or ability or experience, knowledge to do that. So I will amend for the special event fees, because I know that is near and dear to you.
Yeah, and furthermore, there's only one fee, so it's clear that
an event
that takes 60 or 80 hours is getting, you know, is in into the mix.
The proposal is
and a lot of very small special events are being overcharged because of that. So I don't know.
So
I happen to think the Lopers are something we should all support, but
so amended. So I don't know if my second.
So that means amend it back to the zero fee, so we don't have to mess with that anymore?
Yes.
Okay.
I think I have to approve that too. Right?
For the second.
Seconder, yeah. At the risk of crossing paths with Councilman Lennart when he hasn't had his coffee in the morning, I'm going to agree.
Okay. So now we have an amended motion to take the recommendations with the exception of special events. And I suppose if anything comes up in the future, we can always amend them down. We can't go up. But we could amend any of these fees down in the future, correct?
Absolutely.
Okay, but we couldn't double them, because that would be profitable. And that's not allowed. Okay. So, okay, is there any other discussion about this? Okay, then it's just a simple vote.
But just for clarification, is that the reference number S041 in the resolution? Just the permit doesn't pertain to the inspections or the services. There are three special event fees.
Oh, there are three. So what should we do then?
If you look on page 4 of 5 in the resolution, exhibit.
There are other special event fees related to the day of the event for recovery of staff.
So does this
That would not cover, because for example, law enforcement, things like that, being out there at the event, we have to charge for that fire. We have to charge for that. I think we were all in agreement. It was just the permit fee that was the contention we initially had.
Thank you.
They have to pay for the cost if they
have to. So there's 41A for fire and 43 for police and maintenance staff on the day of the event, separate from the S41, the special event permit fee.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. With that clarification, then those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no.
Just amended one or the
no this is the we didn't amend it, they just changed their motion.
No.
So it's okay, so there's one no and four yeses. It passes,
and the motion, as I understood it, included the resolution R215-40 and approving the fee study.
Yes, it was approving the staff recommendation. Okay, we're done with that, right? Thank you very much for your service. Now we'll go to item 2B, another public hearing. Precise plan of design number 15-114 to construct a new 3,800 square foot administration building.
Mr. Mayor, as you all know, this is a matter that would involve the university, LUASC, and four of the council members have declared previous conflicts of interest due to employment or sources of income related to the university and medical center. And so I have the four straws that I prepared, two of which are marked with the vote or participate notation. So I will pass those at this time.
I'm trying to see what's left.
I'd like to know what he does with those straws when they're not being used.
During Councilman Leonard's coffee.
You're not voting.
You are disqualified.
So that means the two of us are in.
So the other two are participants.
Okay. So we'll see you next week. Yeah.
You guys can watch the speech.
They're anti-taxes. Anti-taxes. If you vote for fees, you're relieving taxes.
And so in case that didn't get on the record, Mayor Rigsby and Councilman Daly will participate because they were the winners in the random selection.
I don't know if that winner is appropriate term.
All right, this is precise plan of design number 15-114. Prior to discussion, I distributed a letter from the applicant that they asked that be provided to council and staff as far as information on the project. This is a proposed administrative office building to be at 11104 Anderson Street. It's at the southwest corner of Anderson and University Court. Right now there's some open space and some parking there. This is for administration building for the power plant. Historically, there has been some offices and staff, approximately 10 employees, working in the existing steam plant in the building. They carved out some office space and grew into that over the years. With the campus transformation, there's been a need to expand the power plant and consequently remove those employees to a separate administration building. The zoning is institutional on all four sides. It is also in the institutional zone. It does comply with all the development standards as far as setbacks, height,
lot coverage and building size that does remove 18 parking spaces from the site. However, the university and the medical center runs on a campus-wide master parking program, and these parking slots will be distributed across the campus according to their the parking program and the.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
So, campus, would that include the old community hospital also?
What is the? You have the. Do I have it, or do you have it? That has the. The counts on
just
it.
Just curious how far that boundary of available parking.
Sure.
I think we have Ken Brayer, Loma Linda University. We have an agreement with the city to manage it as a campus, but we're managing the East Campus as a separate campus. So we measure and monitor the parking weekly, but we monitor that as a separate activity.
So that parking doesn't count there?
Yeah, you won't see any of those numbers here. Okay. The pluses or minuses, the surpluses will be entirely separate.
So the furthest east would be like the Drayson.
Right. And the Shepherdson overflow lot, which really is to serve the main campus.
Sorry, to clarify that.
We all learned something. Anyway, kind of the site plan, the building will be on that corner there, you know, where University Anderson and then Taylor Court comes up into the backside of that into a dead end there. Parking plan, there's existing parking along the edges of that open space and down the alleyway from Taylor Court. Those parking spaces will be removed to accommodate the building and access to the side there. Elevations, it's a kind of a modern concrete stucco building, low glass, concrete and glass to match the theme and the existing buildings, a 50s type feel on that corner. And then on the reverse side, there's a architect's rendering. You can see how it kind of fits into the existing buildings and the feel of that. It'll kind of blend in very nicely. Exterior, the yellow, and it's a kind of hard to see that storefront. It kind of loses out here, but essentially aluminum accents around the glass storefront and emollient. Make sure I got everything else on here. And it is compatible with the existing and future uses. It does comply with the general plan and the zoning requirements, and it complies with the development standards of the institutional zone. It, like I said, it matches the buildings and kind of fits into there from an architectural standpoint. It is subject to CEQA, and it's part of the program ERI, which council approved as part of the campus transformation. When was that? About a year and a half ago or so ago. So it does fall inside that. It was part of the program for the power plant expansion and renovation. And that will do it. Any questions? The applicant is here to address questions as well as staff.
How does this affect patient parking for the dental school?
You want the mealy mouth answer, or you want the real answer? Obviously, dental school has parking here. Those parking spaces will be distributed someplace on campus. From a staff perspective, it is part of the master parking plan, and it's internal for the different entities to work out among themselves. The reality is, people that are parking here are going to have to park someplace else and get there. Where they're going to park and what they're going to do, I believe, and the letter from Shared Services does say that at some point that this will be addressed in the future, and dental parking will be dealt with. But The answer is somebody's not going to park there.
I would like to speak to the applicant about that aspect of it. Is Ken ready to?
They are here.
Come on up, Ken.
Ready to be spoken to.
Yes, I'm.
Don't look so enthusiastic.
You know that I have a particular interest in parking. And for just to let everybody know, my conflict has been expunged because of the action of drawing straws, but I've been a member of the university's parking committee for quite a number of years, so I'm aware of a lot of the issues, but this one I'm not totally aware of. When you say that it's a temporary dislocation and that there are plans for dental school parking, that's the kind of a thing that's not known to the committee, at least not when I've attended. What is the plan to relieve the parking for patients who may consider lack of parking to be a reason not to attend the clinics?
We had a discussion on that with the dean of the dental school yesterday. Unfortunately, we have a parking committee that I don't attend. It's the university parking committee, and there I have passed that along to the chairman. But that's really not my prerogative to assign those spaces, which is a reason for this letter. We actually anticipated that in our first letter and realized that was inappropriate because we shouldn't be dictating or indicating who's winning and losing there. So
say that a little louder, Ken.
I said I read the letter after you and I talked yesterday and recognized that we shouldn't be anticipating who wins and loses in that parking game because that's not ours to determine. So I've talked with the chair of the committee, Rod Neal, and he knows that we've got to deal with that. And we started our parking study today. We surveyed this morning. We're going to survey the rest of the week. And we're going to look at the numbers, tell you what the numbers would indicate. Dental school parking is short. There's no question.
And to me, I don't have any standing as a city councilman representing the citizens of Loma Linda to determine how far employees should walk and who should walk and who shouldn't, who should be shuttled, who shouldn't. So to me, I consider that to be irrelevant to my decision. However, there is a certain nexus with patients who attend the dental school. So I'm saying that's the basis upon which I'm trying to decide this thing. If you lose 18 spots, are those currently patient spots or are they employee spots?
I believe most of them are power plant spots. I think they're all power plant spots. However, whatever spaces are allocated to the power plant will come out of the remaining dental school space. So there's an allocation decision that someone's got to make.
Okay, so could therefore the university, in the interests of moving this project forward, plan to have the power plant staff who get a nice, convenient local office be the ones who hike and not the patients?
That can be decided. I'm only telling you I shouldn't be the one deciding that. I understand these.
So to me, see, my interest and to me that whenever I'm considering a project based on its effects on the community, I have to think of the patients and not the employees. So to me, my concerns would be mitigated if those employees were the ones hiking to whatever new parking garages or riding whatever shuttles and then letting the net number of patient spots remain the same. That would mitigate my concern about that.
I agree.
My concern is totally different. I'm not concerned about the employees or the patients. However, I am concerned with public safety. And when I look up there at an already very congested parking situation with the existing buildings and the dental school, my concern is that patients and employees in their haste to get to work or get to an appointment will disregard all of this plan and park out on the street in the public right-of-way in areas that they shouldn't park. So what is, when I look at this, I look at this like any other business being proposed, any other, you know, storefront or whatnot here in the city, and the question is, to do business, is adequate parking being prepared for both customer, client, and employee that it will not affect our traffic flow and our public safety by putting vehicles in the roadway and right away. So that's my concern.
The most, it's been a few years now, but when we first published this as a part of the university master plan, one of the tenets of that plan was that an employee or student should be prepared to walk up to 10 minutes to get to their destination. We've got parking as far away as Benton. We've got parking lot at Lot X, FMO, West Hall parking structure. It could be 10 minutes from some of our destinations. So that has never been rescinded. It's just that, you know, patients, they're the customer. We get that. The issues driving us in construction are simply we've got a hospital that we've tried to serve, yeah. And the OSHPOD realities are pushing us. That's bottom line. We are building three. We built one. We got two more parking structures.
And I just know the realities are that you can tell employees you can't park there. That's patient parking, but they'll still park there, and they'll come up with creative ways to, you know, drive vehicles that you don't have in your plate reader. Cameras, and I mean all the little sneaky stuff that I already know exists. Personally, I'd like to see the dean walk 20 minutes to work.
He walks 10. He walks 10 minutes. I know he parks in the structure.
I'm joking. However, I my concern is just that whole point right there in the plan and everything, with so much that goes on right there in the library and all that stuff that's real close, that it's just a horrible area for parking. And like it or not, I mean, whatever rules that you put in place, but obviously the patients don't have to follow your rules, but even employees aren't necessarily. I work in a building where we tell our employees you're not allowed to park in the parking lot. And every day there are employees that park in the parking lot. And that's just a reality that we, and of course, obviously we have to deal with that, but there's plenty of times you don't know it's an employee car versus a customer, things like that. So.
And I think the university does a pretty good job of finding that out.
Well, yeah, because you have to give them your plates, and then they come by with plate readers.
I was the one that inspired them to do that, because I used to actually use binoculars on the roof of the faculty medical office.
I believe that.
And I identified employees by sight and cited them for parking in the patient parking. So I think the university is pretty good at that one. So your concerns are noted, but I don't think they're as big as you're imagining, because they've got very sophisticated ways of dealing with it. Now, people who don't have plates at all, that's your job to fix.
Consequently,
in your day job.
A couple of years ago, I had to get a document signed by a certain dean, and I went to his office, and I could not find parking. And I consider myself I guess I'm not a client, but should be a VIP or something. No, I'm joking. But, just somebody walking onto the campus trying to find his office, which
that wouldn't be the dental school, would it?
That would have been the dental school. Yeah, I visited your office.
I remember.
Yeah. And it took me about an hour to figure out how to get there and find parking to get
but
there.
But things are, in terms of employees displacing patients from the best parking, I think it's a lot less than it used to be. You know, and I like to, you know, I'll take some of the credit for that, because I was the one who started that process. And I've been in a lot of the committees and heard the reports on how, you know, we're basically keeping people out. And we're going forward and providing tremendous numbers of parking spots in the future. You know, you've read the report. There are 900 excess spots compared to current.
Yes,
but I think...
That's why I asked the question about the East Campus and things like
that. We still have to preserve
the
Central Campus for patients, because I've always felt there's a hierarchy in a clinical spot. The hierarchy is handicap, patients, doctors, general public, or general other or support staff. So the hierarchy is that patients are second only to handicap. And handicap spots are determined by formulas and requirements. So I'm still making my point that I think this should not displace patient parking. And I'm delighted to hear that this is power plant parking, because there's someone that can be moved other than patients that can satisfy my concerns.
Just a note, as a part of our discussion yesterday, we're surveying six lots around the dental school. Obviously, people can go between lots, and if you don't monitor them all, you don't know where people are at. I think that we can work not just with the power plant and the dental school, but there are other people in that area that could reduce their numbers proportionately, and we can still balance this. If you look at the plan on the left, well, on both of them, under University Avenue, there are spaces here. We've talked with parking. We're already moving forward to restripe those.
Not currently, though.
What's that?
There aren't currently.
There aren't currently. Right, but we're going to restripe those back in.
Okay.
Right, between 7 and 9 spaces there.
Is that a city street?
No, that was vacated as a part of the street vacation of University. So the university manages that. My point is there's different spaces around campus. Just off the top in front of Centennial, we have another 48 on one side and, I don't know, 30 on the other. We're building as a part of finishing the Centennial complex. There's another 30 to 35 over by Drayson Center we've designed. So there's little pieces of parking that we're continuing to add.
Yeah,
it's money, it's time, it's staging with all these bigger projects. But
yeah, to me, you would satisfy my concerns if you maintained a patient-only parking lot that's the same size as the patient-only parking lot that preceded this project. Is this planning, are you cutting into patient-only parking at all with this project?
I don't know the numbers at the moment. I know that we're at 197. I think we're at 182 at the moment.
I think I can address that. If they eliminate only the dots you see on the first map, that does not impact patient parking. Mm-hmm. The question is, where do those people park next?
But if the other lots currently marked patient only continue to be marked patient only, then that satisfies my concern that patient-only parking is preserved. Yeah. And I have to count on the university to enforce its own signage.
A scenario. I'm not the official on this, but a scenario that I would propose is that this loss be split evenly between the dental school and the power plant and the others, and that the dental school or somebody acquire that so that it basically would mitigate the dental school's loss on this.
If you're talking about employees, then I consider that to be out of my jurisdiction.
Well,
are you talking about patients or employees?
No, I'm talking about keeping the dental school parking basically where it is now, and the losses would be absorbed by putting somebody out here, and the rest would come out of either the power plant or the other parties around in this area. That's a suggestion. I'm not even on that committee.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm only making a suggestion.
Yeah, but we can place conditions on approval, right?
Well, if you place conditions on a university committee that's not represented here, that's awkward for me.
Let me share my perspective, because I'm sure, I mean, you already have some sense for it, and I just learned about this yesterday afternoon, and I had an evening to reflect on it, plus a couple of emails that I appreciated today. I would feel much better about this if we had been planning this over weeks instead of the day before. I certainly believe that this is a fixable issue and we can protect patient parking, which, as you know, I share that issue with Councilman or Mayor Rigsby. My question is, what is the sense of urgency? Because I didn't even know we were building until yesterday a new central plant administration building. What is the urgency to that? What is the downside to resolving this unresolved issue at this point and then bringing it back for approval?
We are scheduled to have this done, I believe, in June. The project needs to be occupied in June so we can start an OSHPOD project in the plant in July.
You understand the corner you've got me backed into. And it's not the first time. And I'm a fairly patient and a reasonable guy, but I'm losing patience.
If I'd have caught this ahead of time, and I wish I had.
Pardon me?
If I'd have caught this ahead of time, I would have had this at the University Parking Committee first. I just didn't anticipate the problem. I'll own that.
So if we can agree, because I also didn't know until just now we were going to restripe the University Avenue again.
I'm asking for that again. That's got to go.
So that's not already been decided.
Well, we had it requested and it just didn't happen. So I'm trying to push that forward. The only reason would be if someone said they needed that extra lane there. I think the city's agreed to it. We had an agreement.
The restriping?
To restripe it to parking after we closed University Court. with, you know, the staging between Camp University and Stewart Street. Running through there, we added a lane.
The only traffic is that which comes out of the parking lots.
Right.
So it's, and it's, there's no through.
Which will increase now because that becomes the ingress and
this
egress.
This is now exit and
ingress. There's no more exit out the east side of the DP lot.
So all of the patients, the 1,000 patients at the dental school will be going in and out this entrance every day.
Oh, okay. So you're saying everything goes out the left side of that drawing and nothing out the right. Okay. But how does that...
That will increase the traffic on University Court.
You're going to have,
because there's a direct outlet on Anderson.
Correct.
Yeah. But I would expect that it would be pretty easy to do a traffic study on that, but I certainly don't want to condition that because that delays everything.
Why would you do a traffic study? It's a private street now.
Yeah, but you don't... Yeah, but my point is that I'm not as concerned about restriping... You know, number one, we don't have any jurisdiction over it because it's their right. land. But I'm not as concerned about restriping and putting parking spots on University. My net concern is the effect to the general public who attend what is a public place of accommodation in the clinics. So to me, it's about patient parking, and whether you force half of the people in the power plant to hike farther and dental or versus dental people is not my concern, and I don't think it should be our concern as the city council, but that's my take.
Well, there is a basic, and you're correct, from a city perspective, that's not our concern. I agree with you on that.
I actually think forcing employees to hike is a net benefit to their health.
And I expressed to you guys yesterday in the meeting that when all of the dental school faculty currently are either parking down by Centennial Complex or in the new seven-story structure or in the lot behind the church, the structure behind the church, that's where everybody, all staff, all faculty, I am struggling. If this proposal says we're eliminating these spots and it's going to be reduced down to, what is it, four, I think, on the north side, and everybody else is going to park at some perimeter parking like everybody in the dental school does, I've got no problem. I'm there. But when we're trying to preserve near parking, when nobody in the dental school, but I agree with the mayor, that is not a city issue, and I've got to stick to city issues here. But I will tell you that just leaves a bad taste in my mouth.
The territory I don't want to get into is there are critical issues in the power plant. That's the nerve center of our campus. And so there are some spaces that are necessary for
more than four?
Huh? I don't think I'm the one to call that.
Yeah, all right.
I'm just saying, I'm not saying they need 22, but they probably need some number.
Yeah, but
and that's really what a university parking committee should be deciding.
Exactly. From my perspective, how you divide up employees and where they park is not our concern.
That's true.
You can do whatever you want.
I'm not advocating for power plant employees at that location. I'm saying there are company vehicles that come in and out of there to do company business that we need to be able to park there, and someone needs to make a decision on that. I acknowledge that.
Yeah, and
how
the
many
same thing.
How
we
many
applicants to dental school?
How many power plant spots are left when this is gone?
I think it's just those four
on the north side.
Do you think that's enough to accommodate these emergencies? You don't know. Yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah, but you'll have to decide that, and then, you know, if you want to put those in there and then restripe and put the patients out on the street, I have at it, you know. But to me, the principle I'm trying to preserve is to preserve proximal parking for the public accommodation. But that's
what is the specific answer to my question, which is if we work to sort the parking issues out for the people who would be displaced currently. We don't meet again until February. What is the impact on the power plant project, the administration building?
It would be delayed by a month.
And what are the implications of that?
That means it would be completed a month later, which means we can start the seismic retrofit of the steam plant a month later.
Boy, I don't know if we told our city manager that, he would just work double as hard and get it done.
We have a meeting in February 26th. I mean, January 26th.
So 2 weeks.
Yeah, but I don't know. It's, that sounds like to me like an internal university issue that's not really
our concern. I'm not weighing in on any of the internal stuff at all. I would like to see something that talks about the impact to our city streets.
But that's not a city street, so.
Well, Anderson is.
Anderson is, but not university.
I'm not talking about university. I'm talking about Anderson.
Well, from a two pieces, from a parking perspective, there's the master parking plan, and what Luask as an entity does with their parking under that umbrella is an internal issue unto themselves.
Sure.
As far as the city streets, we're looking at parking on Anderson in this area and in this area, and if I'm, and Jarb can correct me, but I believe that area is all non,
it's no, parking.
No parking anyway, so it would not have.
No, but my fear is that it pushes people out onto the street, so I'd like to see.
If it's a no parking area, then our impact would be more parking tickets and tows.
Yeah, it'd be revenue generated.
University is a operated by the university, not by the city.
The University Avenue issue? Yeah, that's University.
So if they wanted to stripe that, they can add as many spots as they want. And then they control it.
If they want to plant petunias in there, that's their private property.
There would be fire ingress egress requirements.
Right. That, I would just inject that. I don't know that it impacts anything, quite frankly, where he's saying to do that. But we would just want to review that. Sometimes there are street spaces that have been counted on to remain street spaces for certain ingress and egress issues. So we just want to make sure.
So I would say, before I'm willing to move on any of this so we can cut this evening short, I would like to see a proposal with that parking stuff on university presented to our fire department and approved before we look at this.
Well, and I mean, all these things go through a normal submission process, which yeah, happens, and so that review will happen. I just would like.
And the
can you get that review done in 2 weeks?
But the striping of university is not even on the docket. No, that was just a proposed.
It's a proposed.
But there's a significant increase in the traffic that are exiting that lot. All exiting the lot will have to come through the same entrance the ingress comes through. So there will be an increase in traffic. So I think the question's a legitimate one.
But the traffic increase is in their driveways, because University Avenue is their driveway. Is that a city concern?
Well, I'm talking about the fire issue.
Yeah, and I can't say right now, sitting here without prevention reviewing the plans, that it really changes anything where there is an issue. We would just want to look at
that.
But
you'd want to do it.
But my question is, Jeff, does this, they're not proposing a restriping of university as part of this project, right?
I don't know. I heard it as part of this project.
Is a restriping of university part of this project?
No.
Or is that's just an after-the-fact possibility that could be reviewed independently? Yeah, so I don't think it's part of this project.
But it would need to be reviewed.
Yeah, but
he's
speculating that they would even do it, right?
So
no,
we
I
could,
understand that. Yeah. But
we could ahead. We could add a condition of approval that university remain, any modifications to university would maintain fire access and
be subject to review.
And would be subject to city review. Yeah. That's certainly something we can do. A little dicier, because it does impinge on the master parking plan, is that maybe we could put something in that, you know, any changes in striping or allocation does not impact patient parking for dental school, but we may be overstepping ourselves.
But at that point, it's a separate review.
Those would all be separate reviews independent of.
And it's not part of this project. This project is eliminating 18 net parking spots, and the condition that I'm proposing to put on it is that those 18 net parking spots not diminish general patient parking. And that's it.
It would be up to the applicant. I'm getting thumbs up, so. I don't
see that it has to delay the approval process. And as far as the building goes, I have to congratulate you. When I looked at that building, I said, that looks like a dental office. So it's you did the job.
Um,
So I think we have to have a public hearing. So we can always talk afterwards, but let's do the public hearing. I'm opening it. I'll try to do a double tap. It was only one. It bounced. Okay, any public like to speak?
The first part is a little bit of comedy and history. In 1970, when Northrop Olson was president, a group came in here and said, if you let us build a four-story parking lot, right here.
That blue button there.
This is Elmer Kelm.
This area right here, and let us charge 25 cents a car, and 10 years we'll give you the title to the whole place. Tacoma Park turned it down. The university didn't. However, as I stopped to look at what could be done, is this the endodontic practice building here?
Yes.
And there's a parking in the back here. There's a shoe store here, and a barbershop here, and a two-story building in here. There's your 3,000 square feet.
Elmer, the first place that you pointed to is the old faculty dental office. Taylor is where the
endodontic shoe store is and the barber shop is. That's two-story.
Yeah.
I mean, why doesn't the university put the administration in there?
It's an old building.
Pardon?
It's a fair question.
Yeah.
It's an old building. Can't go in an old building.
As long as the barber stays. Not that I need a lot of it.
I don't know that I know the answer to that one. We did cast about and ask some questions about moving to some of those areas. Somebody else would have to move. Last time I put that plan together, we had six stages of a move.
What was that?
Dominoes.
We played dominoes the last time. We had six moves to get people moved. So I accepted what was proposed.
Every time you move one person, you have to move someone else and then someone else.
If you move someone into central building, you've got to move somebody out of central building. And where do they go?
Besides the barber shop and the shoe repair store, I don't even know what's in there now.
I think the general sentiment was we're taking power plant activities and we're keeping it in the power plant sector. The initial plan was not to take parking. It was to put it right there on that little green piece of land.
Yeah, I understand.
As a program grew, it can only grow what the setbacks allowed it to grow. So I think that the short answer is we need you to condition us whatever you do and give us something to go on so we can get to work.
Yeah. So is there anyone else from the public who'd like to speak? Seeing no movement, I will close the public hearing. And I understand there were comments that maybe we should do something else, but my feeling is that we should just go ahead with the either approving or denying it based on what's being presented. To me, the issue of the striping on Anderson or on University Court is not a part of this project, and it's something that we can review separately later.
I'll make a motion that we put this off for 2 weeks and hopefully come back with a more complete description of what the implications will be for the project.
I'll second that.
I have another just logistical question. How many votes does it take to approve when we have only three?
All three.
This is not...
There's no expenditure involved. There's no city expenditure involved.
It's a permit. It's not a resolution. Is it?
The only reason you're seeing this is because Planning Commission is conflicted as well. Yeah. So there's no resolution, no ordinance. Were they not conflicted, we would not be discussing this tonight.
So
and does the Planning Commission have a simple majority of those present rule?
They can take an action on a majority of those present. In this case, because it's a permit rather than a resolution or an ordinance, two votes out of three, a majority of the quorum can act.
Okay. Okay, at this point, we have a motion and a second by a majority. So it looks like we're going to have a two-week delay. Is there any other comment? We'll just formalize the vote. So those in favor of delaying 2 weeks, say aye.
Aye.
And I'm opposing, so it's 2-1. It's delayed for 2 weeks. And we will be sitting again. We don't have to draw straws next time. So
that staff is clear, what do you want to see in 2 weeks so that we can present you with the information you're looking for?
It sounds to me like what Councilman Daly wants is internal resolution at the university level.
Well, yes, but that's not the basis of my motion. I also think that there are reasons to have some concern about what I believe is currently three lanes on University Avenue. And I know that the fire trucks inhabit that area far more frequently than I wish they did. And I'm concerned about the ingress-egress issue on there with all of the traffic entering and exiting in the same location.
So staff will bring you a review of traffic. I think we have a traffic study, and then the fire lanes and fire access to that site. Okay. You have traffic counts. We can at least get counts and look at it. We've got some traffic information.
It's not a public street, so I don't think it requires a formal traffic study of any sort, because you're essentially doing a he's requesting a traffic study in a driveway.
I would like to see a report of what the current parking conditions are in Anderson right there and any projected future impact. That's it. Okay. Well, it could be a paragraph.
We will bring you something that shows parking in this area, future, and any our estimates of
projected
parking,
impact.
And any information we'll get you on traffic here and then the fire lane and fire access. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Let's call our colleagues back. Sorry we took so long. We're not allowed to tell you.
I could have gone more than that time. Did you guys finish your burgers? I should have gone.
Okay, now we can get to the consent calendar. Is someone willing to move the whole thing? Any discussion?
I'd like to pull items 3 through 10.
No, I'm joking.
You can just vote no. That'd be quicker. Okay, so there's a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Okay, those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No. That's unanimous. The consent calendar is approved. Old business, Council Bill O-2015-04, second reading, roll call, amending Chapter 17 of the Loma Linda Municipal Code.
This is the one we saw last meeting. This is to, via zoning ordinance, limit the locations of medical marijuana dispensaries, cultivation, and commercial use in the city, and to prohibit those activities in all zones in the city.
I'd like to go ahead and move Council Bill 0 dash. Do we have to have a public hearing on it?
No, the public hearing was last time, okay. And what we'll do is we'll waive the reading. This is one of those with the waive of the reading of the whole bill and by title only, and a roll call vote.
So I'll move Council Bill 0-2015-04.
Is there
I'll second that.
Okay.
So,
and now she'll read the title.
It is entitled An Ordinance of the City Council of the City of Loma Linda, California, amending Chapter 17.100 of the Loma Linda Municipal Code defining and prohibiting medical marijuana dispensaries, cultivation of marijuana, and all commercial medical marijuana uses in the city. And you may vote.
Is it the second button?
It's yes, no, abstain from the top to the bottom. Yes, no, abstain. We're having a hard time reading our buttons.
Hide these things.
They don't light up until you vote.
It passes unanimously. I believe, yes.
Thank you.
And I'll move Council Bill O-
Too much marijuana.
2015-05 and waive reading by title only, reference the massage establishments and new municipal code.
And okay. I want to comment that I'm voting in opposition to this. I think we're trying to fix a problem that doesn't exist in Loma Linda.
Okay.
And potentially putting some businesses out.
Then there was a motion and a second. And
it is entitled An Ordinance of the City Council of the City of Loma Linda, California, repealing and replacing Title 5, Chapter 5.24, and amending Title 17, Chapter 17.44, 17.46, and 17.48 of the Loma Linda Municipal Code relating to California Massage Therapy Council approved massage establishments and massage technicians. You may vote.
Too late, can't think about it.
It's a three.
The suspense is building, my goodness.
It's a 3-2 vote.
Changed my mind from the last vote.
Thank you.
I almost changed my mind, too. You came close. You came close. Okay, new business number 13, appointment of one member to the Planning Commission to fulfill an unexpired term vacated by one of the members.
Has rescinded his application, so there are two applicants remaining. They were invited to this meeting.
Our usual order of business is to review the applications and then have the applicants come forward to make a statement and subject themselves to intense grilling from the City Council. So in the order they are presented, I will ask Carlos Prieto to come forward. You have applied previously for this position, as I recall.
Thank you for having me again. So I have been a citizen here of Loma Linda for, I'm gonna say, going on 7.5 years, and I've enjoyed my time here, both at the university and at the medical center. What I've noticed about Loma Linda is again, its strength in keeping its city on the right track and making sure that it provides a place where families are safe, and I have two daughters, so that greenways are protected and developments are done in a way that they keep the citizens in mind. So I've tried to put in my application my stances on what I think Loma Linda can be. The role, I think, is a great opportunity to get some of these issues that we just discussed today hashed out to make your decision-making process more efficient. you know, some of the pre-work that goes into figuring out the impacts and those sorts of things of developments are important. So having my background in analytics and systems thinking, it's what's ingrained in my approach to reviewing things. So I hope to be of use. Thank you.
Okay, go ahead.
Two quick questions. How familiar are you with Measure V? And if you are, what do you think of it?
I am not familiar with Measure V.
And then the other question I have is, you in your application, you talked about what cities you want to emulate, and one of the ones you mentioned was the city of Mission Hills in Kansas, I guess? Is that what
correct.
It is?
That's my hometown.
And in there you said there was and continues to be a great effort placed on aesthetics and economic vitality of the city without a reliance on business to drive all economic growth. Can you explain what do you mean by that?
Sure. In that particular city, it's a small city of about 3,600. And so it's a family suburb. And so I think from the standpoint that there are sections of Loma Linda that are developed in that sort of sense, I wanted to tie that city with maybe a little bit of Walnut, which has that same feel up maybe towards sections of it and then develops in a planned fashion the business corridors. So it's just a structured approach and what I appreciated about that city.
So are you not saying that the city can generate money without bringing more businesses and only by doing planned communities? Is that what you're saying?
That particular city took that approach. And they're more affluent, so they're able to do that through more of the property tax.
I see.
Average, I think, per capita is $275.
I see. Well, not to belabor the point, but one of the things when we all became council members, we went to Sacramento, and we were given an educational process, understanding where the city gets money from, and they identified what costs the city more, and it had three categories: single-family homes, multifamily homes, and businesses. And they found that anything that has to do with housing, the city will never actually make money from property taxes or any of those fees associated with that, because the cost of providing services to either be homes or multifamily homes so far outweigh the tax advantages. So the only generating positive revenue for a city was businesses. So that's why I was asking you that, because you may not be aware of the fact that a city like that may feel like they're benefiting from having big houses with more taxes, but it doesn't always pencil out. So, anyway.
It's quite possible that Kansas has a higher percentage of the property tax revenue that stays locally also. I don't know. Because here in Loma Linda, for example, we only get 11% of the property tax revenue. So we don't...
The breakdown might be different in Kansas.
That particular city has a unique situation, but it was more for the aesthetics of that as well.
So you do business analytics in regards to what specifically? I mean, what area do you look at?
I work at the medical center, and business analytics focuses in on any financial impact to operations on the clinical operations.
So you look at the cost of providing the service?
Correct.
How do you feel about the parking situation? No, I'm joking.
At the dental school.
Something that could have come up through the planning.
And you would have a university conflict were you to fill this role?
I would have both a university and a medical center, correct?
Yeah, okay. Is the person who left also likewise conflicted? This doesn't increase the conflict.
Even with him on there, even if we appoint somebody without a conflict, the commission will still be conflicted.
Always conflicted, yeah.
So, yeah, the commission is deeply conflicted, yes. And this won't affect it. Okay. Any other questions of this applicant? Okay. You're subject to recall at any time, but you're excused for the moment.
Thank you.
Now we will have Larry Karpenko come forward.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and council members. I heard about a chance to serve our city, and I have two kids that I'm raising here in Loma Linda, and I realize the importance of planned development where there's a balance of housing as well as businesses, and I realize that that plan should be directed by a really good vision, the plan for the city as a guiding. I mentioned that I really had a vision for the city as a healthy place, and even physically healthy place, where, you know, we have safe streets for activities like running and exercising, and good access to the medical facilities. So I just wanted this to be a great place for my kids to be raised. And I thought that I could contribute a perspective from as a parent. I'm well connected with the parent groups and with the schools around in Loma Linda and Redlands. And I have a good pulse for the needs and the voices of the families. So I felt that I could contribute that aspect to this committee. And I'm actually, family is so important in our home that I went to be, when we had our kids, I went to be a stay-at-home dad and to be someone at the home to watch, you know, take care of the kids. And so seeing our, you know, the safety and the and what happens here is really important. That was one thing that I feel like I can also bring is I'm not connected. I'm not on the payroll of any of the, you know, either the university or some of those other businesses. And that can give me a fresh perspective as we're sitting and planning. So I think those are some of the things that I can bring to the planning committee, planning commission. And I do have a lot to learn in this process, but I'm willing to ask a lot of questions and to put time into some of the issues that come. Thank you.
I have a couple questions.
Yes.
How long have you lived in the city of Loma Linda?
Well, I first moved here in 1996 when I attended Loma Linda University.
Okay.
And I've been living here. I bought a place in 2008, and that's around the time when we had our daughter and my wife, and now we have a son.
So total years, seven or more than seven?
Well, I've lived in Loma Linda more than 7 years.
Okay.
Yeah, when I've lived in this area since 1996. Okay. When I came to school.
And are you familiar with Measure V, and you have an opinion on Measure V?
Well, I know some people like it and some people don't.
Well, I want to know what you feel about it.
I don't have an opinion on it right now.
Are you familiar with what it did and why it was approached? Why people wanted it?
I do know that it kept a lot of development, further development, and it let areas be open spaces, and you know, it defined some of the ways that Loma Linda wanted to keep spaces open. Yeah. At the time. So
okay. And you do realize because of the law of the land,
yeah,
all projects have to comply with that. So
yes.
And another quick question, you said you liked Roseville, and one of the things you talked about was being able to have bike rides. I'm
yes.
assuming that's more like mountain biking versus road biking, or?
Yes, just a few miles off the main interstate there in Roseville, they have this wonderful park where you can take a mountain bike on sort of a roll, path set roll, you know, rolling around. It's also, it's paved so you can actually rollerblade on it. Okay. So I like the idea that there's a place where there's a paved road where that brings a lot of people in for walks and things, and it doesn't necessarily put you in isolated mountains or...
Do you see a place in Loma Linda that we could do that?
I do. I actually live off Beaumont Avenue, and I live right up against Beaumont, and I see the runners, I see walking every day, especially on weekends. I think that there could be some areas along Beaumont that can be strengthened in terms of, you know, designated bike path or more designated. I realize that there's some places where walkers have to switch sides, where sidewalks eliminate. And so even as a driver, you're not sure where to look if there's someone walking on the right side or the left side. I think that there's an opportunity there to have a more defined space that can be connected to up to Holder Crooks Park. And I'd like to see something. It's traveled so heavily that I really think that it's just a matter of time before there could be an accident or something in that area. And, you know, I think that's an opportunity for our city actually to define itself as somewhere that's proactive for pedestrians and bike riders included. We can actually make a statement, you know, having a green pathway or something like that is a way for us to make a statement. Hey, we're friendly for those who are walking and who are on their feet, and we want to encourage that. That whole concept of a healthy place is something that I even think can spill over into the, you know, what types of businesses that we have here in the city. It can define who we want to give permits to, who we want to generate that income through business revenue, business tax revenues. It's actually something that can guide a lot of the debates in terms of the directions our city with a vision of, you know, it's a healthy place. And I actually remember when the Mountain View Road Bridge project was completed, and I was really thankful when they expanded that bridge because it gave the access, especially over to the Veterans Hospital. And so those, even to me, in my mind, that fits into this vision where we're saying we want the community and the extended community to be able to have access to our resources. And that's what's going to continue to make Loma Linda even a better place, is when people say, hey, in fact, I like the discussion tonight when they say, well, we know we're going to go get dental care because there's a place for us to park and walk across to get our dental treatment done. I really appreciate that high expectation that the patients are, they need to know that they're a priority and they have a place to park and a place to come get the services here at the city. So those are some of the ways that I see our city continuing to become better and better.
So where you, in your vision of Loma Linda, you make the statement that you would like to see incentive for businesses that promote healthy living. What kind of businesses would those be?
Well, I think, I was really glad to see Walmart when they came in, but they came in with a food market. And that's nice because people are out. It brought competition to some of the other food stores. And that really helps bring a reasonable amount. When the businesses can compete for providing us services, especially food service. We're getting two companies now to compete over who's going to sell lettuce for the cheapest. So I'm really in favor for that. I'm glad that you brought in something that's going to compete versus if it was just a Walmart that was just selling basic goods. That may not have kept a competition for, you know, vegetables on our dinner plate. So those are the sort of things.
There are a lot of people who would say that were against Walmart and say that it wasn't promoting healthy living. So how would you say about McDonald's promoting competition against Patio Pantry or whatever you call it?
The thing about the Walmart, and I will go directly to your question, but the thing about Walmart is you brought in a neighborhood market Walmart. That's a very specific part of Walmart. And so that competed directly with Stater Brothers. That Walmart didn't compete with our neighborhood food Walmart market does not compete with Target. Well, I guess Target has some food supplies, but it doesn't compete with a general store. McDonald's, it's mixed. I mean, I actually went in there for the first time.
You don't have to answer that. That was kind of a rhetorical question.
They do have a veggie burger, question. But.
So incentive for business approach and healthy living, what if there's a business that promoted something that you personally didn't consider healthy living? Do you think we shouldn't subsidize that to get it here?
That's where I do feel like the Planning Commission is a process. That's why there's a team. I can have an opportunity to state, I don't personally like this business, but it can still move forward. Maybe my own opinion in that scenario, maybe it's too narrow, but that, you know, there's going to be a committee there that we can work together. If they say, no, this is going to bring good revenues in, let's move forward. I can understand the process, and I do respect the process. I know Guillermo works with the group, and I want to respect the process about discussing what comes up and then moving forward. Thank you for your question.
Any other questions? Okay, then you're excused temporarily unless we have other questions.
Thank you.
At this point, we usually start discussing the candidates, and usually our comments will tell what our preferences are. I'm impressed with both candidates. I think they're both very good candidates. You may have differences on what they believe in, but there seems to be a certain deferential attitude to them that they would defer to the interests of the community. I'm planning to support Mr. Prieto. I supported his application last time. He is an excellent analyst at the medical center. I have personal experience with his approach. He's quiet, but he's a deep thinker, and he really puts in his homework and gets the job done. So I appreciate that both have applied, but I'm planning to support Mr. Prieto. What are your other comments, those of you who have?
I would agree with you that I think they're both highly qualified, and they both have a good vision, and they would both make good Planning Commission members. I think they both have great assets. I do appreciate the fact that Mr. Prieto actually came back a second time and applied. I think, at least lately, we've been finding out that we've had to make a number of these appointments on a regular basis. In the past, it used to be not that often, but lately it seems like people are coming and going more often. So anybody who perseveres and comes back a second time shows that they have initiative, and I think that's a very good strength. And whoever doesn't get voted in has the opportunity to probably give it another shot again. Yeah, I would actually...
We have regular openings.
Yeah. I would actually agree with you, Mayor Rigsby. I would support Mr. Prieto as well, not to take anything against Mr. Carpeco. I think he would make a fine Planning Commission as well. But the fact that this is the second time and he's demonstrated his interest and willingness to serve, I think that's a strong sign to me. And that's really the driving factor. I think if both of you came in, both fresh off the street, it would be a little bit harder. But the fact that we've gone through a second interview with you gives you a little bit of a more credibility to me. So,
no other particular comments. Go ahead.
I was trying to think of whether I had anything to add to those comments. I don't think I do. I think both are very, very, would be very good on it. I served on that myself, and I think they both would do a good job on it. I figure out a tiebreaker, and I guess the tiebreaker might be the same thing you said. Somebody, Mr. Prieto was here first, applied before. So. Okay.
We don't need to go any further unless you've got.
No, I'm just going to say I appreciate both of your civic interest in participating, not just being an observer in this. And as usual, I think Mr. Popescu has logic that makes sense. And
as usual, you say?
Yeah. No, it's, yeah. Impeccable logic. But I think the tiebreaker is this is your second effort, and to come back a second time is noteworthy and admirable, and shows a serious attitude about this. So I appreciate that very much. But I would encourage you to stay in touch with us too, because as already has been noted, there are many opportunities to participate in city government here. What is it, the Parks and Recreation Committee? Yeah, if you want to get into the debate of Little League and Pony League, then there's lots of fire in that one. Thank you both very much.
Hey, real quick question for Mr. Prieto. Are you related to, in any way, to Don Kurth? This is more of a curiosity. Sure. But.
I started my MBA program at the School of Public Health in 2006. And I think he joined in at about the time he was running for mayorship in Rancho Cucamonga. So I had him as a classmate for, I want to approximate, four or so classes. So, yeah, no personal relation.
Okay. I'm Facebook stalking both of you right now. So.
Oh, sure.
That's how I do my research.
Just as an FYI, I haven't logged into Facebook since I got married in 5 years ago, so I may still have an X there or two.
All right, so let me rescind this friend request. No, I'm joking. I'm not going to tell you guys which direction I'm really going to go. No. I support the other council members. I agree, and you have been here, and this is you've come back a second time, and I'm glad you didn't get discouraged. I do know of Mr. Karpenko, and I also think very highly of him, and I'll throw him a vote just because. But unfortunately, it's not going to matter, and I do wish you the best of luck, and I hopefully we'll have some exciting things we'll all get to work on together.
Welcome to the Planning Commission.
Thank you.
Just out of curiosity, how long ago did you apply? How long ago, last time you went? Because it's been a couple of years.
About a year ago. 1 year.
And who was up with you at that time? Do you remember?
There was a gentleman and a gal who was also at a family.
It was the architect, engineer guy.
Okay.
He had lots of specific
from what
experience.
I read. Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you both. Okay. Are there any reports of councilmen? Any reports of officers?
I have something. And I know Jarb's going to send some staff members tomorrow morning.
Yes.
The California League of Cities. Excuse me, if you don't have anything to share with the rest of the class. No. California League of Cities, of which you guys know that I'm the representative of our local chapter, we are putting on some training tomorrow, which is pretty neat, and it's in lieu of the events that happened in San Bernardino. And I'm connected to this training in another way. In the city of Rancho Cucamonga, has been working on an active shooter training program for years now, probably 10, 15 years, in both with the sheriff's department there and the fire department, in a very unique training scenario that now is getting worldwide attention. And now the Sheriff's Department's going to adopt as a kind of a standard. But anyway, immediately right after the events in San Bernardino, Ranch Cucamonga decided that they wanted to start putting on some community-based training for citizens, business owners, and public employees, non-law enforcement public employees, that may be interested in what do I do in that type of situation? What's the best alternative? What should I be thinking about? That type of stuff. So we put together this program. It's a 3-hour program, and again, it's for community members. So there's nothing, you know, law enforcement really about it, but it's a really, really neat thing. So immediately, League of Cities thought that would be a great thing to really put out there for all of our local cities here in the community. So we're hosting this training free of charge tomorrow, and I'm going to put it out there. I know Jarb already knows about it, and he's sending some city employees tomorrow. Several cities I heard Rialto is going to pretty much shut down their entire city and send all their city staff. There's some elected, some people like that, but if you're interested tomorrow morning, if you can, it's from 9 to noon in the city of Ranch Cucamonga at the Cultural Center at Victoria Gardens. And it's actually very, very good, very interesting training. So that's all I got. If you have any questions, hit me up afterwards.
I do have one report.
Go ahead.
Whenever you're ready. Just an update, something to note from dispatch. Recently, our county sheriffs and Confire dispatch centers rolled out, I think, first county in the state, text to 911. So you are all able now to text 911 to report an emergency through the PSAP, so police or fire emergencies. If you think of, to some degree, the deaf community, some of the methods that they've used previously to communicate, it's different, it's updated, it's digital, and they use devices now where they historically hadn't, now use this technology. And some instances where victims may not be able to talk via voice communications can now transmit that. When it first went live, we kind of asked, well, what's our anticipation of use of this? And the thought was that it would slowly ramp up, and after only a couple weeks of being in play here, we've already had several instances where it saved lives. One, I have a couple of the notes here, as I saw, was a 52-year-old deaf female who reported chest pain, got fire department paramedic response, and was transported and actually went through procedures and is alive today because of her ability to text to 911. Another note I took was a 15-year-old was afraid to talk, so he texted the report of his father had doused himself with gasoline and family members was threatening to light everybody off. And the 15-year-old was able to communicate with law enforcement response to stop that incident. So anyway, interesting. First county in the state to roll this out, one of the few in the nation, as I understand. But that technology is now in play. So whoever in the community is watching, that's a resource you now have.
Thank you. Go ahead.
I have one more. Last week, we did very well at the rain. During the rain, all the flood mitigation device that we put up and put in and install are working. So we did pretty well, including all the tree trimming that we did.
Yeah, and I noticed they were out clearing the gutters and drains during the rain. So that was very good. Okay, any other reports? Then the city council is adjourned, and we move to our successor agency to the Loma Linda Redevelopment Agency agenda. Are there any items to be added or deleted?
Sir.
Would the public like to speak on any non-agendized items, meaning anything other than the demands register and the minutes? No takers. So what's your pleasure on the consent calendar?
I'll move it.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. It's unanimously approved. That agenda is adjourned. Next, we go to the Housing Authority agenda. Are there any items to be added or deleted?
No, sir.
Would the public like to speak on any non-agenda items? Hearing none, we have a closed session report.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I did report previously that on the real estate matter listed on the agenda, there's direction to staff, negotiators, but no final action at this time.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure anyone who just tuned in gets the latest. Okay, are there, what's the opinion of the committee on the consent calendar?
I'll move it.
I wanted to take a quick peek at item number 3 about limitations of gifts.
I'll second it so we can discuss.
Okay, so Madam Secretary, what is the issue?
We have had some applicants for the affordable housing, to purchase affordable housing, and who have exceeded income limits. If they just exceed income limits based upon their income tax and their W-2s, that's a pretty easy situation to say you've exceeded your limits. But we have had some come in where family members want to provide a gift to the potential buyer. We've had some offers for cash sales of $250,000, which really circumvents the program. Mm-hmm. And so to make it more clear for applicants and for those who may want to give an applicant help with down payment or something like that, our legal counsel examined the issue and indicated that a good number which would not skew their income would be a maximum $14,000. So any amount up to $14,000 could be determined as a gift and would not skew the income for purposes of purchasing that affordable home.
Are there not state laws that mandate some of that, or is it really up to us?
It's up to us as far as what
the
could
gifts.
Be a gift okay. toward the home.
And the lender looks at that too.
Right. And that gift then could be put toward the down payment to reduce the principal, go toward closing costs, other expenses.
But clearly somebody outright offering to purchase the entire house
that's no.
circumventing something.
That's correct.
Yeah. All right. Sounds good. Thank you for the explanation. I think you seconded, so.
Any further discussion on this? Okay, those in favor of the motion to approve the consent calendar say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. That's unanimous. It's approved. And that agenda is, are there any reports from the members or officers? Okay, then that one is adjourned, and we will see you all in 2 weeks.
Indeed.